Welcome to Beatles. Welcome.
So what other games have we got? I don't know. I'm so confused. It's been so sunny.
1964 spring. I've been in the south of France, hanging out, you know, doing the typical thing that people, young English people, do in those days. I'll still do today, probably. I've been a deckhand in the south of France, and I came back to London. And I was living in Chelsea, and my friend said, it was just when the Beatles had happened. And people said, you're from the north of England, aren't you? I said, yes, it's Liverpool. I said, no, well, Manchester. He said, well, it's near Liverpool. He said, well, why don't you go and find another group, you know, like the Beatles? So I actually went out scouting, and I was working for a company called Prestige Pressure Cookers. I was a trainee executive. I got a job with them. My family were very happy. And in 1 week, I actually discovered a group called Spencer Davis with Stevie Winwood, of which Chris Blackwell picked up for Island Records. Herman's Hermits through Charlie Silverman, and they turned them down, and Mickey Most picked them up. But the group we did keep, and I did discover, was in a group called the Moat House, a club called the Moat House in Birmingham, with the Moody Blues, and Denny Lane was singing lead. And I remember the song he was singing when I discovered them was called Bye Bye Birdie. And they'd only been together a week. And they were a combination of the five best groups in Birmingham formed into one group. And I actually took them to London, got them a flat, got them the instruments, we got them a recording contract with Decca. And the first record we put out was called Lose Your Money, But Don't Lose Your Mind. And then one day, I was at a party at a friend's house in Harley Street, and sitting on this sofa was James Coburn, Pete Cameron, who did The Weavers and Harry Belafonte, and also later on was the executive producer of The Who. And he's sort of a money man from America. And in the middle was B. Mitchell Reed, Beamer, the great disc jockey from WNCA New York. And I knew at that time the Stones, who were just beginning, had a lot of R&B songs on their, this is spring 64, man. And I used to happen to be talking to B. Mitchell Reed, because I knew that was the way to get a record. I said, look, if you get any R&B songs, please send me one for the Moody Blues. And James Coburn was looking at me, and he said, you know, I'm probably listening to me talk, and he said, you look like the Beatles, man. You should be a disc jockey in America. He said, we need a disc jockey, an English disc jockey. And I didn't really want to know what he was talking about. I really just wanted a record for the Moody Blues. And God bless Mitchell, because he's passed away now. He did send us a record, and it was Go Now, Betsy Banks record. And it did go to number one. It's one of the greatest, I think, one of the greatest 3-minute records that's ever been made. That was my first break, as we say. And I did take James Coburn's advice, because I got kicked out of the Moody Blues organization, because they didn't think I knew anything about rock and roll. So I discovered the group, brought him to London, did all I could for him, and then these terrible people, God bless them, kicked me out. And my mother didn't know what I was going to do, and I just went to the American Embassy, and I said, I'd like to be a disc jockey in America. I've been offered a job. I knew I could do radio. I knew I had a voice a certain time. Because somebody had offered me a job on Radio Caroline. Because Caroline had just started. Being a Chelsea boy, anybody who could talk just about could get a job on Caroline at that time. And the American embassy threw me out. And he said, do you realize, young man, in America it takes... they start at 14 to 15 cleaning out the radio stations. You know, no Englishman will ever be a DJ in America. I'm quite despondent. I walked out of the Grosvenor Square, America, and across the other side of the square is the Canadian embassy. I thought, well, what have I got to lose? So I went to the Canadian embassy, and the fellow said to me, young man, we need men like you in Canada. It's a land of golden opportunities. He said, we'll even pay your airfare. So within 10 days, I was on a plane, Air Canada, on my way to Montreal, with $27 in my pocket. No job, nothing. But I did have an aunt in Montreal, and I still remember a cold autumn night, October the 14th, or whatever it was, arriving in Montreal, being picked up by this long, huge station wagon, American Chevy, as I. And the first night, the very first night I was there, the radio DJ was going on about this and that, and the Beatles and the Stones, and the Stones will never be as big as the Beatles. And I said to my cousin, who's about 13, I said, that's a load of crap, rubbish. I said, the Rolling Stones had just been voted the number one group in England by the NME. He said, well, you can speak to the DJ. Before I ever knew it, he dialed the DJ, stuck the phone in my ear, and I can hear the DJ to this day saying, Dave Boxer, CFCF, Radio Montreal, what can I do for you? I said, excuse me, my name is Timothy Hudson. I've just arrived this very night from London. I'd like to correct you on one small point. And when it's like the DJ, when they don't have a script, they're absolutely stunned. You know, he said, well, get it out, what do we want to say? I said, you're incorrect about the Beatles and the Rolling Stones. And I told him the fact about the Rolling Stones. Well, next thing you know, he says, I'd like to come to my show tomorrow night and talk about London. And there I was, radio the next night, the little phones were ringing off the hook, the girls were going crazy to my accent. Within 3 days I was on television, and within 2 weeks I had a radio show. And from there, I got written up in the Billboard or Cashbox as the first English disc jockey in Canada. And next thing I knew, the station changed format. It always does on you. They went middle of the road. I was out of work, but the program director wrote to Billboard and put an ad in. Very good English disc jockey, very knowledgeable, just been to England to interview all the groups, etc., etc., available. Next thing I knew, there were telephone calls coming in. And this gentleman said to me, my name's Lee Bartell. I'm president of Fatima Martell Media. I own 28 publications, including Photoplay, radio stations from San Diego to San Francisco to New York to Puerto Rico. Where would you like to work? I said, sunshine, please. Anyway, get me out of Montreal. I've been in Montreal all winter, freezing to death. Next thing I know, I'm on a plane. I'm having publicity pictures taken like this, right? You know, with Tom Jones' black shoes, my black pinay, you know, my black silk suit, you know, little slit up the side, my John Michael shirt, my little knitted tie, my little hair, little beetle haircut, right? And he's offering me a fortune to me at that time, right? He offers me, he said, don't worry, I'll get you a green card. He said, I'm a friend of Hubert Humphreys, you know, just being elected Vice President of the United States. Next thing I knew, I'm in San Diego, I'm in the papers, I'm on television, I've got a green MGB sports car, I'm on my way. Next thing I know, he says, the Beatles are going to tour America this year. He says, so why don't you call your friends the Beatles? Because I didn't know the Beatles. I'd known them since 1959 from the Jacaranda in Liverpool. So I thought, bloody hell, the Beatles are not going to invite me to tour America. I mean, there's no bloody way, right? So I wrote them a very nice letter, right, the station. Next thing I know, I get an invitation back. Of course you can join the tour of America. You're on the aeroplane, here's the ticket. Come to the hotel, the Warwick Hotel. So there I was, one of the seven disc jockeys touring America, and America was pulling its hair out. Before I knew it, all these DJs says, hey, you go to Hollywood, New York, Chicago, boy. They ain't leaving you in San Diego. And sure enough, I was on my way. So the last thing I did in San Diego was I presented the Beatles. And next thing I knew, I was on my way to Hollywood, KFWB.